Josh, happy birthday. Happy belated birthday from the Busted Open Nation.
Thanks, guys. Thanks for having me on this morning, too. I really appreciate it.
How did you spend your birthday?
My wife took me to Top Golf. I'm a huge golfer, and Top Golf just opened up here in Columbus, so we went there and had a great afternoon. It was fun.
Bully, you ever get into the golfing? You don't look like a golfer, Bully, are you?
I like to drive the golf cart to drink beer.
I've been known to use my driver every once in a while. So how are you, Josh? It's been a while, man.
Yeah, I'm good. You know, we went on sale this morning for homecoming, and front row are gone within an hour, which is awesome. And we sold almost out of our VIP packages from last week, so a good sign of things to come for the pay-per-view. But I've been great. We just relocated to Columbus not too long ago, so I'm enjoying the lovely weather that comes with living in northern Ohio. But everything's good, man.
Oh, yeah. This is not the time you want to be in Ohio.
You're not kidding.
Josh, let's talk a little Impact Wrestling. How do you feel the company has been moving forward over the past couple of months?
Well, I think when you look at the whole year of 2018 and what we did, it's been exciting. I mean, pay-per-views that were critically acclaimed, going back to Slammiversary and then Bound for Glory, I thought was really good. And then we get ready for Homecoming in 2019. So I think the uptick has been good. And I mean, just a credit to the fans who stuck with us for all these years, really, and watched the transitions and the changes and didn't give up on Impact. And then the people that are coming back, I think they're getting a quality product, a great unpredictable 2 hours each week if you're not reading spoilers, and great pay-per-views. I don't think you can ask for much else from a company.
And Josh, Bully and I talked about it at the time, and I was in attendance in New York for Bound for Glory. And to hear, you know, a sold-out crowd, you know, chanting Impact Wrestling, you know, for somebody that's gone through the trials and tribulations of this company over the last few years, that had to be very satisfying for you.
I mean, it's great. We had the same response in Las Vegas. We were just there for our TV tapings at Sam's Town Casino, and we're doing the things that I think everyone wanted Impact to do over the years, and that's put on shows and get out of the Impact Zone, get out of Orlando, and get out there. I mean, we've been to Mexico. We did the U.K., we have our Twitch specials every month and One Night Only specials every month. And I just think it's a rebirth and a resurgence that was, much needed.
Josh, are you a part of the creative process within TNA?
No, that's the only department in the entire company that I don't have a say or anything in. I think those guys do an awesome job. I talk to Sanjay Dutt, 400 times a day. And I think those guys do great. That's literally the only thing that I don't partake in. So they'll meet, and then after they're done, Sanjay and I get together, and then we come up with, like, the marketing for the shows each week and how we want to pitch each angle and try to get the most out of what they're doing with creative.
Looking at this through a fan's eyes, I know you've been around the wrestling business for a long time, but if you were a fan of Impact Wrestling, what is one of the next things you'd like to see them do to take steps forward?
Well, I think we have to, I think everyone obviously knows that we have to get our television on a better time, right? 10 o'clock on Thursdays is an ideal. So I think you'd want to get that into more of the primetime location. And then I think you just, as a fan, I just don't want to be, I think Impact over the years has often, not done the right thing by the fans. And I think that was a big thing in 2018 with the pay-per-views is let's deliver great pay-per-views that have great matches, that have solid finishes, that aren't the finishes that maybe you're used to seeing from Impact over the years. And I think we did that in 18. I think you have to earn the fans' trust back, one fan at a time. And I think that we're doing that. I don't think that anyone's getting fooled or anyone's being taken. I think that if you're paying for a pay-per-view, you're getting your money's worth. And that's the other thing, too, about our VIP packages. I mean, we put those up now, and we don't even tell people, what those are going to entail. But we're selling them because fans know they're repeat customers, that they're going to get their money's worth by spending $250 on a VIP package. Okay, I know I'm going to get to go bowling with Pentagon, or I'm going to get to have breakfast with Conan. Like, you're going to get your money's worth each and every time that we deliver on these pay-per-views and TV tapings.
And Josh, I think the biggest obstacle, and I think that Impact Wrestling has done a tremendous job with it, is really focusing on the talent that isn't former WWE talent. And I mean that in a lot of ways, like, you know, the big criticism of the old regime is that it was WWE light. You can't say that about Impact Wrestling right now, because when you talk about the biggest stars on that roster, you're talking about Eli Drake. You're talking about Tessa Blanchard. You're talking about Brian Cage. You know, these are names that are really, in a lot of ways, synonymous with Impact Wrestling, and I think that's a big win for the company.
And when you look at those guys, right, and then you look at LAX, I mean, yep, as a tag team bully, when you look at what they did in 2018, I mean, from Impact versus Lucha Underground in April, then they went to the UK and took on Fleisch and Storm. I mean, they've been a three-time world tag team champions, and these guys are barely in their 20s. I think that when you look at the best tag team in 2018, you have to look at LAX and what those guys have done. I mean, I text Santana probably two or three times a week, just telling him how great I think those guys are doing and what they've done to improve. And, I mean, that's an Impact tag team right there for sure. And then you have Pentagon and Phoenix, who are all over, but they're on Impact each and every week. And you're right about Cage. I think Johnny Impact as world champion is a great representative. And then Tessa Blanchard, I mean, my God, she's got to be probably the second best female wrestler on the planet.
Do you think Brian Cage is used properly in Impact Wrestling?
I think so. I mean, I'm looking back at when he started. He didn't talk. He beat everybody. He's got an incredible arsenal of moves, becomes X Division champion. Now he's looking to become world champion. I think he's used properly. Do you, you don't think so?
I'm just wondering, because I see such I don't know what the right word is, but to have a man that large be the X Division champion, he does all of that stuff so well. To me, he looks like a prototypical world heavyweight champion, and that's, I mean, he's the Scott Steiner of 2018, 2019. That guy's got world heavyweight championship potential written all over him, and that's the direction I'd love to see him go. That's why I was always, I kind of questioned why the X Division stuff happened, despite the fact that he can do that X Division stuff really well.
Yeah, I think I might have questioned that too when he was put into that X Division match at the pay-per-view. But if you look at the path to the championship, the world championship for Cage, now he's going to use option C at Homecoming. He's going to face Johnny Impact for the world championship on January 6th. So I think the path he took might have been untraditional by going after the X Division championship and then using it as option C. But we're still getting Impact versus Cage for the world title at Homecoming. And then I think it's cool that we're also getting the return of Ultimate X at Homecoming. You know, that was a staple for Impact for many, many years, as you guys know, and it returns at Homecoming, which I think is very cool. And you got four guys in that match. I'm not going to spoil who's in, but four guys in that match who are probably going to light the world on fire on the 6th of January.
I agree. And again, Homecoming is on January 6th. You can get tickets right now. They went on sale this morning, and it's called Homecoming for a reason. It's back at the Asylum in Nashville, Tennessee. And you said it. You know, Johnny Impact champion, going up against Brian Cage, your X Division champion. He's taking option C. And then you have Tessa Blanchard going up against Taya. We saw that at Bound for Glory. So she gets her rematch at Homecoming. So two tremendous matches. And like you said, the Ultimate X match, the return of the Ultimate X match for the X Division championship. And Josh, it is curious in the fact that I thought that Impact has done great strides to kind of make people forget about TNA. Not that TNA was a bad thing. For a number of years, I thought TNA was a better wrestling product than what we saw with the WWE. You know, 2009, 2010, 2011, 2012, those were tremendous years for TNA. But interesting that Impact is going back home and kind of, you know, giving a nod to their past with TNA. Is that a good thing or a bad thing? Because I really think you made great strides to make people put TNA into the past.
I think it's a catch-22. And we've had these conversations, like, you are going back to Nashville, you're going back to the Asylum. And I can't comment on what this company was doing in those years that you mentioned, because as you guys know, when you're in WWE, you're in that bubble. Like, nothing else exists. Mm-hmm. So that's what's been so fun for me since parting from there, is just to see everything else, like actually going to my first independent wrestling show after being in the business for like 17 years and having Sanjay laugh at me when I asked where catering was. There's just, you know, I get to experience this all now in my late 30s, which is kind of cool. But to answer your question, it is a catch 22. Like, we're going to go back to homecoming. We're going to go back to Nashville. And I don't think you're going to see the people that you saw in the asylum all those years ago. You're going to see Impact Wrestling in 2019. So I think it is a nod to the past. But it's also just an opportunity to be in a different city. We haven't been in Nashville for so long. I used to ask Dixie that all the time. Why don't we run shows here in Nashville? But we're going to be there. We're going to be at the Asylum, which I think is cool. But you're going to get the product that we've been putting forth since the beginning of this year.
Okay, Joshua, I got to ask this question, and hopefully you give us an honest answer, not the politically correct one. What was your opinion on what went down with Austin Aries at Bound for Glory?
Well, I thought the match was awesome. And then the end, I didn't necessarily think was what I probably would have wanted to see. I mean, it's so hard, Bubba, for me to, like, give you a super honest answer, you know, as the voice of Impact Wrestling. But I thought it was a little I wouldn't want a championship celebration to end like that. I think Johnny should have gotten the spotlight that he deserves and deserved on that night. I think it was, you know, marred in controversy. But, you know, people were talking about Impact the next day. People were talking about Impact throughout that week and what transpired with Aries. And look, we haven't seen Aries since, and we haven't heard his name spoken. We haven't seen him. So, I mean, to be determined and to be continued, I suppose. But to answer your question bluntly, I don't think I would have liked to see Austin Aries do what he did at the end of that show when that match ended.
I think that's a very fair answer, and you handled it perfectly. So let me follow it up with this. What is there a current status between Impact and Austin Aries? Not that you need Austin Aries in any way, shape, or form, but is there something on the horizon?
Honestly, I don't know. Okay. I don't know the answer to that question. I think that's a question for Scott or Don or Ed, even. If they're having those conversations, I don't know the answer to that.
Fair enough.
And for something that was such a hot topic, I mean, Bully and I were obviously talking about that the next day, Josh, about what Aries did at Bound for Glory, you know, the biggest pay-per-view of the year for you guys. But you guys did a good job of steering clear from it. And honestly, it almost feels like it blew over. You know, you didn't make any mention of it on the show the next week. You didn't show any clips of Austin Aries. You really highlighted, you know, Johnny Impact as your new champion. No matter what the future holds, and who knows with Austin Aries, because like Bully said, we haven't seen him. But I thought the company as a whole did a good job of steering clear of it.
You know, it reminded me of when CM Punk left WWE, and we would go back to Chicago, and all the fans there would chant his name. And I was specifically told, if they start chanting for CM Punk, just stop what you're doing and say, you know, we haven't seen CM Punk. He walked out on the WWE Universe, and we haven't seen him since. And it sort of felt like that a little bit. We forgot about Austin, and to your point, we did. We spotlighted Johnny, and we talked about the World Championship.
But you're not getting, you know, unlike the WWE with the CM Punk chants, it's not like Impact Wrestling fans are chanting for Austin Aries. So I think that's
that's great.
Yeah. All right. Okay. Go ahead, Bully. I'm sorry.
One of the characters there that I enjoy a lot, I wanted to get your opinion on it, Josh, is the Sue Young character. I think that girl does a phenomenal job from beginning to end with it. How is she being received in TNA? Impact Wrestling,
Sue's
sorry.
No, that's okay. Sue's been awesome. I mean, I was talking to my wife about their rivalry not too long ago, and I thought what they did, and in the woods and the bloodbath and everything from, to like your point, Bully, from beginning to end, Sue is the complete package, and she could wrestle. I mean, if you look back at her and Madison's match from the pay-per-view, they had a good match. And I think Sue is a complete package. She's so many layers to her and what she can do. She is, you know, she's that character, right? And in wrestling, you have to love characters, The Undertaker, the guys like that, that are characters from the time they walk out to the time they leave. And I think that's what you have with Sue.
You know, talk about Tessa Blanchard, you know, your Impact Women's Champion, your Knockouts Champion. You know, she was a big free agent that we talked about on this show a lot, and seeing where she was going to land. How big of an impact, excuse the pun, has she made with the company, and how big was it to be able to sign her and secure her for Impact Wrestling?
I think it speaks volumes to the company and where we are right now, and Tessa deciding that she's going to come to Impact and be here for a good chunk of time. And I mean, Tessa could have gone anywhere, right? She could have signed with WWE or gone the NXT route, or she could have wrote her own ticket and instead decided to come to Impact. And Tessa's been great. I mean, behind the scenes, in front of the camera, anything you need her to do, she does. I mean, she's just been an absolute joy to work with. And, you know, that was the knock on Tessa for all those years, right, was that she had a bad attitude. And none of us have experienced a bad attitude from Tessa since the day she walked through the doors.
That's awesome.
Josh, one of the seems like complaints that most WWE wrestling fans have is that the WWE doesn't, quote unquote, listen to their fan base. Do you believe that Impact listens to their fan base?
I think we listen to our fan base. I do. We put up those surveys at the end of every episode online. You can fill them out. Those do get looked at and read and discussed and talked about. So I think in that aspect we do. We clearly listen to them with how they wanted big time matches to end and have clear finishes and definitive answers to questions. And I think that we do a great job of listening to the fans. I think that if you ask the fans what matches they want to see at Homecoming, you know, Johnny versus Cage is right there. And then the World Tag Team Championship match that actually gets made Thursday, so I won't spoil it. If that match doesn't steal the show on the 6th, then I don't know what match will.
That's awesome. And again, Homecoming is taking place on January 6th. Tickets are available right now at the Nashville Fairgrounds. And Josh, you've had a lot of broadcast partners over the years. What's it like working with Don Callis?
I think it's been great. I mean, this isn't a politically correct answer either, and I know the position that Don holds with the company, but I've really enjoyed working with Don. Everyone's different, right? I mean, when I worked with Taz for all those years, we would speak like daily. Matt Stryker and I traveled together. Michael Cole and I traveled together for years. Don and I mean, we have a great relationship. We talk periodically, but we sit down, and I think we have great chemistry. And I actually told him the first night in Vegas when we took our headsets off, I said, that's the best show that we've ever called. And the hardest thing for us really is that it's a puzzle. So if we do 4 episodes in 2 days, 4 of those episodes are being shot in one night. So I'm bouncing from like episode 1848 to 1846, you know, so trying to keep up with what stories have happened, what hasn't happened yet. And we're calling it all live. It's such a challenging task. But at the end of those Vegas shows, I mean, I told him, I said, Don, I don't think we've done any better than we did here over the last couple of days.
That's great. And one other question, Josh, and again, Homecoming, tickets available now, January 6th in Nashville. You mentioned it to start the interview, and that's the TV home. And there's a lot of speculation, you know, the contract is coming up on Pop TV. What are you hopeful to see? You know, what home would you like to land in for 2019?
It's such a hard question to answer because there's so many options right now. I mean, in the digital age that we live in, I mean, is it best to be on Netflix or Hulu or Amazon Prime or any of those outside the traditional TV box places where you can put a TV show? I mean, look at the money that Netflix is spending on original programming. It's insane. And then Hulu wants to match what they're doing. And then now that we know where WWE is going to be and they're going to be on Fox, it opens up so many different doors. So it's such a we could debate this for hours as to where the best place is to be on television. We have to see what these new trademarks mean for this up-and-coming thing that's happening and see what they're going to do. Mm-hmm. But it's such a fun time to be a wrestling fan and to be in the wrestling business because there's just so many different options and places for your show to air. And where will we land? And that's the question that, you know, we all kind of want to wait and see, knowing that we will be somewhere, this company will exist into 2019 and beyond.
It's funny because we've talked a lot, Josh, on this show about this new promotion and, you know, everything with the owner of the Jaguars and, you know, Khan and what could be taking place. You know, when you look at that, for you being involved with Impact Wrestling, is that a good thing or a bad thing? Does that help your options or does that hurt your options? Because honestly, you know, we just hear about the trademarks, but we really don't know what the hell is going on with this new company, if there's a new company.
And then what does it mean for Ring of Honor?
Yep.
And where do they go? And just so many different questions. And it's so much fun to talk about it. Personally, my stake is with Impact Wrestling. I'm here. And I think that we have a tremendous growth potential, but then just to be able to look on the outside and then to be married to someone who's actually a competitor, and for her to have other places to work, even though her home is Ring of Honor and she signed there for the next year, it's just, you know, it's fun.
Again, homecoming taking place on January 6th at the Nashville Fairgrounds. Tickets are on sale right now. We already have two matches that are completely signed. Tessa Blanchard, your Impact Knockouts champion, going up against Taya, that rematch from Bound for Glory. And, of course, your Impact world champion, Johnny Impact, going up against Brian Cage, that option C for that world title match. And Josh, it's been an absolute pleasure having you on. Can't wait for homecoming. And we really love what we're seeing Thursday nights, at least for right now, on Pop TV.
Guys, thank you so much. I know everyone wants to be on this show, so thank you for allowing me the time to come on and talk about homecoming and get the word out there for the pay-per-view in 2019.
Great job, Josh.
Thanks, guys.